Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord some praises. I know. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Bless your name, God. We lift his name on high. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. We give you praise, God. You've been good. Since we woke up this morning, Lord God, you allowed us to see another day. We bless your name. We are in our right minds. We are in the house of the Lord. We're ready to see your word. Let's give him some praise.
Oh,
Praise the Lord, everybody. Is anybody glad that he's high in all the earth? That we serve a God who's the name above every name. Anybody glad that you made it to the last service of revival? Come on, who's been blessed already? Can we just give God praise for what he's already said? Come on, there's been some preaching in this house, and we're so grateful to God. We are better for it. I believe that God is moving us and pushing us forward to do the work of God. Amen? We are the New Macedonia Baptist Church, where we're demonstrating God's love, and we are discipling God's people. And we're doing that by connecting, growing, and serving. Come on, my friends, my brothers, and my sisters, in the physical sanctuary, in our virtual sanctuary, will you join me in a word of prayer? God, we thank you. We thank you, God, for what our ears have already heard. We thank you for what our hearts have already felt. And we thank you for the mission and the mantle that you've already given us to carry it out. Now, God, we've come for the last service in this revival. And, God, we thank you that you still have more left to say. So, God, we've come with expectation. God, we expect you to not just go beyond what we expect. We expect you to blow our minds, do something wonderful and miraculous even in this service. God, we're believing that you will still heal, set free, and deliver. God, we thank you for your manservant. We thank you for Dr. Pointer, God. We thank you for how you've preached them all week long. Now, God, we pray right now that you give him a double dose of your anointing. Even now, God, that you would preach him in ways and manners that he wouldn't even begin to understand. God, we know he studied, but he needs your spirit. He's prepared, but God, give him your power so that we may be better. So that we can go out into this world and make the simple declaration that Jesus saves. We give you glory. We give you praise. For it's in Jesus' name we do pray our hearts and souls. Amen. Amen. Amen and amen.
Come on, new masters. Give the Lord a hand of praise in this space. Come on, give God a real praise. Why don't you go out of your way and greet somebody real quick. Greet them with the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tell them how excited you are to see them. In fact, ask them, where did they park? Where did they park today? Ask them, where did they park? Make sure they're not on the Massachusetts Avenue side. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, sir, it's good for us to be here. Come on, give God praise in this space. Come on, give him glory. Anybody excited to be in the service of the Lord? Come on, give the Lord glory right here, right here. Give him glory. For the Lord is good. Said the Lord is good. And he's worthy. Yes, he is. He's worthy of all of our praise. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're grateful to God, and we certainly give reverence to him and his wonderful son, Jesus, who is the Christ, through the power and personality of the Holy Spirit of God. Celebrate all the leaders of our church, our pastors, our ministers, members of our diaconate ministry teams. Amen. Thank God for all of our ministry teams for their service, even as unto the Lord. Let's praise the Lord for our awesome music and worship ministry team serving all week long. This amazing band, cadre of musicians, psalmists, and singers under the leadership of Sister Tamaria Bradley, our incomparable Tamaria Bradley, our minister of music. I want to thank our media ministry team as well, those volunteers who make sure our stream has gone forth, our ushers who have served all week. We praise the Lord for each and every one of you. I even thank God for Minister Nicholas Padilla today. He came in my office. Came in my office and said, man, I don't know whether to hang you or hug you. Lord have mercy. These preachers have been running me all over the place this week. But I'm glad to see them. Thank God for them. We bless the Lord and give God praise. Thank God for Dr. Ivy being with us. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And we give God praise, Pastor G, Pastor P. Amen. God is so good, and our most new doctor in the house, the newly minted doctor, we praise God and give him praise for his faithfulness toward us. Let me just ask you real quick, and I'm going to get out of the way of the preacher. Have you been blessed during this Noonday revival? Please don't fool me. You've been blessed during this Noonday revival. God has moved in miraculous ways. I'm thankful to the Lord for this awesome and anointed preacher who once again thought it not robbery to come and to share with us. Amen. As I shared on Tuesday, he has been preaching at the New Macedonia Church all of his ministry life. Amen. This is the first place he preached outside of his home church. Amen. And I'm thankful to the Lord for the vision of Dr. Robert Lee Walls. Amen. To see something in this young preacher. Amen. And my predecessor was one who thought it not robbery to encourage young preachers. Amen. And the investment has paid off in great dividends down through the years. Amen. I can't even imagine how those who poured into Dr. Pointer's life at such a young age around this DMV and gave opportunities, how they look with gleam and certainly excitement to see what the Lord has done, even those who look over the balconies of heaven. But I praise the Lord for Pastor Pointer so willingly and graciously accepting the invitation to come and to share with us. He has a very busy preaching schedule, serves the local church, amen, the wonderful people there in Little Rock are so gracious to allow him to use his gift to bless the body of Christ around the country, amen. He serves faithfully that congregation, leads that congregation faithfully, and now serving in the academy, mentoring pastors and preachers in a doctoral cohort. It is the most famed doctoral cohort in the nation. It's the most famed one in the nation, and so United Theological Seminary, the Pointer Brown Goodman Group. And so we are grateful to God. I want you in this moment. I've been trusting them all week. I said, just put the ushers where. But I see you all are stretching my trust level. Amen, somebody. Amen. Because you get so excited and he comes and takes you in such a historical state that you forget to leave your offering. I can't trust you. I ain't got no more days. This is the last day. So I'm going to ask our ushers if they will prepare to receive our offering, amen, in this moment, amen. We're going to take these moments now to make sure that those who desire to give, I mean, because I knew it was in your heart to give, but you're just so excited and shouting and rejoicing when you left, amen. It didn't get from your heart to that bucket, amen. But I needed to get to the bucket, amen, so that we can bless this preacher. It would be robbery for us not to bless this preacher the way he has blessed us this week. Amen. So those of you who can and will give a very generous gift, whatever gifts are received at the noonday, these gifts go to bless Dr. Pointer. Amen. These gifts go to bless directly to Dr. Pointer. Amen. If you're viewing us online, we ask you if you use electronic means. I receive texts and posts from all across the country of persons who've been watching this revival. Amen. That's no exaggeration. All across the country who've been tuning in, we simply ask you to honor God's servant, bless him as he has been a blessing to you. Is that all right? Amen, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, we love you. When we give you praise, we offer our thanksgiving for your servant whom you have used once again mightily to bless this people. And God, we believe that you're going to use them again. But we give these gifts as an expression of our appreciation for the servant of God. You told us in your word, let the one who is taught the word share in all good things with the one who teaches. And so, God, we want to bless him. We want to bless him today. So use our hands to bless his heart in the strong and matchless name of your wonderful son, Jesus Christ. Amen and thank God. After we receive these gifts, the next voice you'll hear is that of God's servant in the person of the Reverend Dr. Phillip Pointer, Sr.
The ways you made for me. this last watch revival, I'm going to ask you one more time to join me in whispering words of prayer. Let's ask the Lord to bless our time in the Word. God, we are indeed grateful because we are recipients of a grace that is indescribable, that has manifested itself once again in this privilege of corporate worship, where we've come to lift you and to be made better followers of Jesus Christ. Now, God, it's preaching time, and I stand in desperate need of you. I absolutely cannot do this without you. One more time, pour fresh oil on my head. One more time, give me clarity of thought and precision of speech. One more time, use me as an instrument in your hand. Give your people what we need to hear, to understand, and to obey. Help us to leave this place better than we were when we came. That's our sincere prayer. Would you please rebuke any potential distraction and help us to be focused on the scripture as it reveals your Son, Jesus Christ. Save somebody. Reclaim somebody. Build up believers. And please do it while getting all the glory for yourself. We believe you're going to do it because we pray it by faith in accordance with your will as revealed in your word. And in the name of your Son, who is our Savior, Jesus the Christ. And all who believed and agreed said amen and amen. Well, if you love my Lord, can you clap those hands as you're taking your seat? This is the day the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. You may have your seats. Let me honor our great God, who's great and greatly to be praised. And honor God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who saves sinners, and the Spirit of God, who seals and sanctifies the saints. Once again, New Mass, help me to celebrate your pastor, my friend, my brother, Pastor Patrick Walker. He's a unique gift to the body of Christ, a leader par excellence. I'm grateful, sir. Amen. And I'm grateful today to stand to announce that he has consecrated me yesterday. He consecrated me yesterday as the bishop of the Noonday Revival, and so I receive it by faith in Jesus' name. Isn't that what you said? Isn't that what you said? That's what you said. You said. That's what you said. I'm grateful to be with my friend, and always grateful to be with you, the New Macedonia family, friends, and those who are members and guests. We are grateful to God to be here. To all who share the blessed burden of the preaching assignment, and all of you, my Father's children, one more time, come to Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. Our last look for this year's meeting at the Great Commission on Tuesday afternoon, we said you got to do it with your doubts. Yesterday, we simply tried to encourage you to do your duty. Today, one more aspect, I'd like to take the prism of this truth and shine it through the white light of interpretation and application and see if we can't find another color on the rainbow of this incredible commission. This, Matthew 28, verse 16, concluding at verse 20, the CSB once again translates it. The 11 disciples traveled to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped, but some doubted. Jesus came near and said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This last time together for this year, I'd like to put a tag on our time and trek through this text. I just want to talk about the dispatcher of our duty. You may be seated. Thank you for standing. The dispatcher of our duty. Poland's famous prime minister was named Paderewski, who was not just a skilled leader and politician. Paderewski was also a famed concert pianist. He had a show at the opera house there in Poland, the music hall filled to capacity. In the front row was a young mother and her 5-year-old son. He had just started piano lessons, and she thought seeing Paderewski in his excellence and his musical prowess would inspire her young son to practice and to play at perhaps a high level as well. She turned around to speak to some friends, and when she turned back, this 5-year-old child had disappeared. The lights dropped, the curtain was drawn, and to her great shock and chagrin, her 5-year-old boy had made his way up the steps onto the stage. He was sitting at that grand piano, and with one finger at a time, he was plucking out Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. She was aghast. She was embarrassed and shocked until the maestro, Paderewski, walked up behind the young man, whispered in his ear, and said, "Keep playing." Paderewski reached around that young budding musician and put his right hand on the keys and began to play a soaring melody. Then, putting his left hand on the keys, he picked up a bass line to fill in the gaps. And as the two played together, the music was indistinguishably excellent. You could not tell who was the maestro and who was the novice. They stood up together at the end of this would-be performance, and both of them gave a deep bow. The young novice playing with one finger at a time, and the maestro reaching around and playing with excellence and expertise. Friends, in the same way, our best efforts to carry out the Great Commission are simply Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. Your testimony, your knowledge of God, your biblical astuteness, our preaching and teaching and praying is all Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. Your attempts at community involvement and engagement, your attempts to speak truth to power and address injustice, your attempts to sing songs of Zion, all of our best efforts at working for God are simple melodies played on the keys of our lives. What makes us able to do this impossible task of taking the good news of grace to the entire world, crossing cultures and boundaries and seeing God save humankind? It's not our strategies, our expertise. It's not the expansiveness of our vocabularies. No, it's because the maestro of heaven, the Lord of glory, Jesus Christ himself, comes up behind us and puts his right hand on the keys and his left hand on the keys and makes a melody of mercy that brings people closer to the cross, that makes them say, "What must I do to be saved?" Church, all I'm trying to say is that Jesus is the one who makes the commission great. Our ability to carry out the commission is completely dependent on the one who crafted and conveys it. You need Jesus, my friend, to get the job of the Great Commission done. And by the way, any aspect of your personal purpose, any goal you desire to achieve, any height you aspire to reach, any place in life that you desire to go, you're going to need the maestro of heaven to play the keys with you. Friend, this rock
robs us of arrogance and conceit and a sense of overinflated self. This helps us not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but to think soberly. Are y'all in here with me? To recognize that who I am, the Lord made me, and where I'm going, the Lord's going to take me, and what I have, the Lord gave me, and what I know, the Lord taught me. And if I am ever going to do the Great Commission, I need the Great Commissioner to help me get it done. That's the context of the commission. It was spoken in this tension of doubt and duty. The content of the commission calls us to go make disciples of people that may not necessarily look like us, but affirming their identity being with us and with God, and then teaching them to observe what Christ has commanded us. But between that content is sandwiched between two statements of personal power that make the content doable. Miss Ilona, I'm trying to explain. What you're called to do, you can't do. So what he does is he puts himself in front of you and then puts himself behind you, so that in front of the Great Commission's content, there's the Christ. And behind the Great Commission's content is also the Christ. And so what makes the text doable is the one who dispatches us to do the duty. Tonight or today, my brothers and sisters, it's those personal pronouns upon which hang all the significance of these words. Listen to them. All authority is given to me. And on the back end, I am with you. You don't know what to shout about that. Me and that I are places where churches ought to erupt. Let's try it again. All authority has been given to me, and then on the backside, I am. I'm through now. Revival is over. I gotta go. Y'all gotta go. But can I tell you about the me? And can I tell you about the I? And then I'll let you go ahead and get your lunch. The me means he has ready ultimate authority. One dark Friday, they marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. They whipped him with a cat of nine tails, with some 39 stripes, that leather whip that had sheep bone and metal in it, that literally ripped ribbons of flesh and muscle from his back. They crowned him with 73 thorns, placing it upon his brow, pressing it into his flesh. And then, friends, they stripped him naked, beat him senseless, gave him a reed for a scepter, and began to mockingly bow before him as he claimed to be the king of the Jews. They then convicted him of trumped up charges of being a blasphemer in the Jewish court and being a treasonous in the Roman court. They then sentenced him to death and marched him out of the gates of Jerusalem to a skull-shaped hill, where they hung him high. I thought y'all were Baptists. And stretched him wide and dropped him low, and he hung there, friends, for 6 hours on Friday, 3 in the light, and then 3 mysteriously in the midday dark wind. At 12 noon, the sun turned off its light and refused to shine. He died until justice was satisfied, until my sin debt was paid, until the earth rocked and reeled like a drunk man, until the rocks split and dead men got up out of the graves and walked around Jerusalem. And then they took him down, buried him in a borrowed tomb, stayed there all night Friday, all day Saturday, all Saturday night. But early Sunday morning, he got up from the grave, stood on resurrection ground, and said, all no, not power in the power we think is power. No, it's the word ousia, it's the word authority. This is not muscle might or sovereign strength. This is divinely delegated authority to a human person. This authority that Jesus is speaking of is the authority that, according to Philippians 2, gives him the right to be called the name that is above every name. Let me teach you something else. The name that's above every name is not Jesus, it's Lord. Because there were other Jesuses, but there's only one Lord. And his lordship is affirmed and verified through the resurrection, through the passive reality of the resurrection. Paul's early writings tell us Jesus didn't just get up, God raised him up. It's a picture of the divine person, the unseen person of God, verifying that the sacrifice of Jesus Christ is fully sufficient and that his obedience was fully complete, so that he can be trusted with the scepter of humankind and he can be the fulfillment of what God told those Israelites in Genesis 49 and 10, that the scepter would never leave the house of Judah. It's the fulfillment of the Davidic covenant of 2 Samuel 7 that David's descendant would always sit on the throne. Jesus, y'all, has delegated authority. My daddy says it this way. An 18-wheeler is speeding down 495. And a police officer stands in the middle of the highway and puts his hand up. The truck screeches to a halt because it has the power, but he has the authority. It's not an assumed power or display of might. It's the result of submission, sublimation, surrender, and sacrifice. It means that we are sent out by a sufferer who has been rewarded for his suffering. Because the commission will bring to you controversy and calamity. But Jesus, standing with the holes still in his hand while in resurrection, he says, if it's worth it for me. I see you don't know what to shout about. It's going to be worth it for you. So this is why in Philippians 2, Paul says he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross. In church, God is calling us to have a Christ-like surrender and sacrifice, because real authority comes when I'm willing to go through the agony that must precede it. And while you're running from the pain of purpose, you're also running from the authority that can be delegated to you by the one who says, I have it all and I'm trying to give you some. I don't know if this is making sense. It's this. He says, you gotta go because I'm telling you to go. But you can go because I'm telling you to go. No, let's try it again. You gotta go because I've ordered you to go. I have commanded you to go. I am dispatching you to go based on the reality of my own authority, but you can go because the one who is telling you to go sees ahead what you're going to have to deal with, what you're going to have to go through, the pains and the pressures and the problems that are going to come with carrying out the commission, because ain't no way to do purpose without having some problems. There's no way, because people are fickle and funny and the world is anti the gospel and the society doesn't want to see folks saved, and we got the eternal enemy of our souls, Satan, who is plotting and scheming in order to try to keep us from doing our job. But Jesus says, I'm so powerful, I got so much authority that the word I speak over your life guarantees you effectiveness and victory in the midst of whatever you gotta face. So must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. This consecrated cross I'll bear till death shall set me free, then go home my crown to wear. But there's a crown for me to serve this present. I've been sent by the one who has ultimate authority. Me. All authority, watch him, has been given to me. It was 1970 when Colorado Institute of Technology, a man named William Onken Jr., wrote about an analysis of authority, suggesting that authority has at least four components. It's the authority of competence, the authority of position, the authority of personality, and the authority of character. We don't have time for all of that, but I do need you to know that in every area, as he scored people's legitimacy as it relates to their authority, of course, nobody had a perfect score in competency, position, personality, and character. But he forgot to interview one more candidate who knows what he's doing in competency, who has been high, lifted up, resurrected, and sits at the right hand of God in position, who is the perfect person as it relates to personality, somebody in personality who's easy to talk to and people want to follow, because I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then little light from heaven filled my soul, bathed my heart in love, and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus makes me whole. He's got the kind of personality that makes him altogether lovely, the kind of personality that makes him the fairest of 10,000, the kind of personality that makes me want to bow my knees in worship and prayer and praise. But then he's got character. He's got the credit rating that he does whatever he says he's going to do, and he does not lie, and he cannot fail, and he always comes through. And so the perfect score for the one who has legitimate authority is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he says, that's the one that's sending you. I gotta move. That's enough. One more thing. Can I tell you about the I? The me means he has ultimate authority. The I assures us of his unending presence. But one day, I'm gonna teach somebody's church how to shout on reading the Bible. And I want to try it. I want to try some at the end of verse 20. And O King James says, lo, L-O. Lo is a powerful word. It means pay attention. Sit up. Be intentional about calling to mind. The CSB translates it, remember. It should have an exclamation point after it. Because he's saying, I need you to keep this in mind in all your movements. The thing I don't ever want you to forget, no matter what you face, what you fight, where you go, what you deal with, here's what I need you to know. I am with you. No. Teach you how to shout. You forgot who the I is. The I is the I that is standing up, having just gotten up from the grave. The water walking I. The fish and bread multiplying I. The blind eye opening I. The unhearing ear opening I. The eye who spits on the ground, makes miracle with, puts it on a man's eyes, tells him to wash, and he comes forth seeing. That eye. The storm stopping eye. I wish y'all were in here with me. The eye who said before Abraham was, I am, which makes him the same eye that stepped out of nowhere onto nothing, grabbed nothing, spoke to nothing, and made everything. That eye who caused the worlds to twirl and baptized them in a liquid mist. The eye who put the moo in a cow and the hiss in a snake and the red in the watermelon and green in the grass and a hoot in the owl. That eye who woke you up this morning and who has been keeping you and sustaining you, that eye that was dead and is now alive forevermore, that eye said, I don't care where you got to go and what you got to do and what you got to face, you won't ever have to face it by yourself. I am with you. I'm gone. But one famous writer said, memory is the art of attention. One more time. Memory is the art of attention. I remember what I choose to pay attention to. Because if it's out of sight, it's going to probably be out of mind. So every morning when I wake up and every night when I lay down, I gotta spend a little time saying, you know what? The only way I made it through this day is because you decided to be with me. I wonder, can you look back down the hallway of your history and take a trek back down your times of trouble and see that no matter where you've been or what you've gone through, you had somebody on your side. I've seen the lightning flash, heard the thunder roar, felt sin breakers dash, trying to conquer my soul, but I heard the voice of my Savior. He bid me to still fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. The world's fierce winds are blowing, temptations sharp and keen. I have a peace in knowing that my Savior stands between. He stands, yeah, to shield me from danger. When all my friends are gone, hey, yeah, and he promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. When in affliction's valley I tread the road of care, my Savior helps me carry my cross so heavy to bear. Though all around me is darkness and earthly joys are flown, my Savior whispers his promise never to leave me alone. I got to leave y'all here now, but there's one more verse to that hymn. He died, yes, on Calvary's mountain. For me, they pierced his side. For me, he opened that fountain, that crimson cleansing tide. For me, he's waiting in glory upon his heavenly throne. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. I got to leave you here now, but can I get you to turn and encourage somebody and say, neighbor, you're not by yourself. Tell them, no, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. I got to leave you here, but is that your testimony? He walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own, and the joy that we share as we tarry there, none other, none other, none other has ever known. Let me borrow your hand just one more time. Would you turn, 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 and shake one more hand and say, neighbor, the only way I made it this far is because he's been with me. That That's how I made it through the trial. That's how I made it through the test. That's how I made it through court. That's how I made it through surgery. That's why my bills are paid. That's why I got a peace of my mind. Because he decided never to leave me. He's been walking right by my side. And my testimony is there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No, one else can heal all our souls in here. Walk with you. Won't he hold your hand? Won't he guide your feet? Is there anybody here glad he's with you? Say it! We got to go now, church. It's been a long week, y'all. But can I get you to encourage a new neighbor? If you gotta cross the aisle to do it, can I get you to find somebody you ain't talked to yet and say, neighbor, I just got one question. I need one answer. Tell them I've seen a whole lot of things. I've been a whole lot of places. I've had a whole lot of storms. I need you to help somebody and say, neighbor, I just got one question. I want you to answer me quickly. Ask him, ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Do you know him? Have you tried him? He's all right. All right. I don't know what you're going through, but one thing I know, you're not by yourself. He's right there.
Somebody ought to give him glory. Somebody ought to give him glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad he's with you? Aren't you glad he's with you? Hallelujah. Woo! Promise never to leave me, never forsake me. Hey! Glory, glory! My God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. What a word. God bless you. We thank God for each of you who have shared during this amazing spring revival. Thankful to God for what God has done and how God has used this man of God to bless us once again. Come on, let's thank the Lord for the Reverend Dr. Phillip Lamont Pointer Sr. What a blessing, what a blessing, what a blessing. I want to thank, again, all of these pastors, many of which have passed through almost every day. Pastor Pettiford, of course. Thank God for you, Pastor Hawkins, amen. Again, Dr. Ivy, Pastor G, Pastor Perrin, of course, and others who have come. And if I miss you, please forgive me. Please forgive me. I am grateful. I don't take it for granted. Amen. What God has done and how God has blessed us again this year. This has been an amazing revival. Have you been blessed, New Mass? Hallelujah. We are so thankful to our God. We want to continue to lift Pastor Pointer up in prayer as he continues to make proclamation of the truth of God's word. Grateful to God for our night revival. Amen. What a blessing. What a blessing on last night. Amen. Pastor Frank Thomas Jr. blessed our souls on, my God, on last night. And of course, Dr. John Arfason, amen, on Monday and Tuesday. It's been a great revival. I said it's been a great revival. And we are thankful to our God. Again, New Mass, let me just real quick, and I'm going to ask Dr. Point if he would come and close us out on the final day, as is our custom. But we thank God again for this music and worship ministry team who served all week long. Amen. Thank you all so very much. Our media team, those of you viewing online, amen. We appreciate you, but we could not bring it to you without the volunteers who serve in our media team. Amen. Brother Keel had to leave his job because some of the settings and somebody didn't show up, et cetera, et cetera. But to make sure that the noonday service was broadcast, and I appreciate it. I don't take it for granted. I want to thank our own pastors and ministers who supported this week, and our diaconate teams. Of course, your support means so much in this revival season. Let me remind our men, amen, we'll be in our men and our young men's breakfast. We need to hear from you today. Amen. We need to hear from you today so that we can prepare to feed. If you have not registered, amen, would you do that? Sponsor a young man. Register yourself and sponsor a young man. Bring a young man with you on Saturday morning at 8:30. Amen. Amen. And we bless the name of God. Your pastor is in a series. Amen. And the self-proclaimed bishop at noonday ruined my series. Amen. So I'll be going out of town. I probably won't be back for about a month or so. Nonetheless, amen, we're going to pick up this post-resurrection revival, what God is saying. And I don't think it's accident. I don't think it's by accident what God is speaking to us. I didn't talk to Pastor Pointer because God knows I would not have talked to him if I knew I was going to open up a post-resurrection series. But it's so poignant and so timely, and we have to hear what God is saying to the church. I wish I had a witness here. And a great, 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 great time, and we've been challenged and we've been stretched. So we're looking forward to continuing this revival spirit. Amen? Amen. We thank and give God praise. Come on, Pastor Pointer, would you dismiss us in your own way? We did settle the discussion yesterday in terms of who's taller between you and Frank.
For the record, I'm taller than Pastor Frank Harris Jr. I am also taller than Reverend Dr. John R. Faison. Amen. And I want you to pray for your pastor, Newman's. Being tall is actually a handicap because we just read Jesus said, "Lo, I'll be with you." He didn't say anything about tall. He said, low, I'll be with you. Praise the Lord. I'm in the book. I'm just reading. I'm just telling you what the Bible say. Just telling you what the Bible say. Pastor, thank you, man. I love you, and I thank God for the friendship and your brotherhood. New Mass, it's always wonderful to see you and to be a part of this. Would you pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course
and be glorified, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. For all men have not faith, but God is faithful, who will establish you and keep you from the evil one. God, we thank you for these series of services where we've asked you to send revival. And I pray, Lord, that as you have been consistently speaking, that you would help us to consistently heed and do the work that you called the church to do. Now, God, I thank you for this pastor and these people. And I thank you for all who have gathered, both physically and virtually. I pray that our time together would be fruitful in such a way that revival actually begins tomorrow. When we live out what we've learned. So, Lord, send the revival and let it begin in each of us. Now take us to our several destinations under your protective covering and care, and give us safe passage. And God, help us to have a productive remainder of the day and productive remainder of our lives for the sake of your glory. In Jesus' name. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power now and forever. And the people of God said together, amen. God bless you.